Hi, one and all. Welcome back again in another session of Human Anatomy and Physiology. So today we will discuss the another topic. It is called tissues. Tissue is a group of similar cells specialized to carry on a particular function. Tissue is available in all our body parts. Tissues are nothing but the cells plus extracellular matrix minus non-living portion of tissue that supports cells. There are basically four types of tissues. In that first is epithelial tissues. Its normal function is to do protection, secretion and absorption. Second type is connective tissue, which is a major function of support soft body parts, for example heart or liver or lungs, liver, and bind structures together like peritoneum. Muscle, its major function is to do movement. And fourth type is nervous tissue. So there are four types of tissues, and the function of nervous tissue is conduct impulses used to help control and coordinate body activities. Here we will discuss the classification of tissues. The classification is very vast, so you have to recall all the names. In that, the first class is epithelium tissue. In epithelium tissue, again there are two types. In that, first is simple epithelium. In that simple epithelium, it can be divided into again four types. That first is simple squamous epithelium. B is simple cuboidal epithelium. C type is simple columnar epithelium, and D type is pseudo stratified columnar epithelium. Now second type of epithelium tissue is stratified epithelium. Again, it is divided into four types. In that, A, stratified squamous epithelium. B, stratified cuboidal epithelium. C, stratified columnar epithelium. And D, transitional epithelium. Now we will switch out to the second type of tissue. It is muscular tissue. Again, it is divided into three types. A, skeletal muscle. B, cardiac muscle. C, and smooth muscle. Third type, nervous tissue. And the fourth type is connective tissue. Again, in connective tissue, it can be divided into two basic types. In that, first is embryonic connective tissue. In that, A, mesenchyme, and B is mucous connective tissue. Now, second type is mature connective tissue. In that second type, it is divided into five different types. In that, A, loose connective tissue. This loose connective tissue is divided into three types. First, areolar connective tissue. Second, adipose connective tissue. Third, reticular connective tissue. And B type is dense connective. Dense can be divided into three classes. First, dense regular connective. Second, dense irregular connective. And third, elastic connective. Now C type, cartilage. It can be divided into again three types. First, hyaline cartilage. Second, fibrocartilage. And third, elastic cartilage. Now D type, it is bone tissue. E type, it is liquid connective tissue. Again, it can be divided into two types, blood, and second, lymph. So students, in this fashion, the classification has been covered. Now we will start from the epithelial tissue. Now as we know, epithelial tissue is the superficial part of our body. So it protects our whole body from the external resources or from the external pathogens. And its characteristics now we will discuss. That first is, it is free surface open to the outside or an open internal space. It is basement membrane anchors epithelium to underlying connective tissue. So it is the upper part of, or it is superficial part of the connective tissue. Below that, connective tissue is located. So it protects the internal part of our body. So either it will be connective tissue or any next tissue is available in our body. It lack blood vessels. It is not having any blood supply. It is readily divided. For example, skin healing. So as if any part will be damaged of our skin, so immediately rupture and repairing process will be occur. So it is a continuous process. It occurs in our body. Epithelial tissue are tightly packed with little extracellular space. Now classification of epithelial tissue. It can be classified on shape and numbers of cell layers. On shape, if you will see, it can be classified into three types. Squamous. Squamous is nothing but the thin or flat cells. Cuboidal. Cuboidal are nothing but the cube shaped cells. And third is columnar. Columnar are nothing but the tall and elongated cell. They are bed like structures. And according to numbers, there are two types. One is simple, means single layer, and stratified, means two or more layer cells. It covers body surfaces, covers and line internal organs, and compose glands. For example, skin cells, cells that line the stomach and small intestine and inside your mouth. Now we will start from the simple squamous epithelium. It is nothing but a single layer thin flattened cells. It look like a fried egg and it is easily damaged and common at site of filtration, diffusion, osmosis and covers surfaces. And air sacs of lungs, walls of capillaries, lining of blood and lymph vessels are available. Now if you will see in this figure, so here you will find this. So it contains cytoplasm, nucleus and basement membrane. It is irregularly shaped mesenchymal cells embedded in semi-fluid ground substance that contains delicate reticular fibers. And its location, if you will see, it almost exclusively under the skin, means under your skin you will find, and along development of the bones of embryo and some in adult connective tissues and especially just above the blood vessels. Now we'll go for the next one. It is called simple cuboidal epithelium. So here it is a single layer of cube shaped cells centrally located in nucleus, and its main function is to do secretion and absorptions. And its location is surface of ovaries, lining of kidneys, tubules and lining of ducts of certain glands. So here you will find it is in the lining of the kidneys. So here, especially in the various ducts, means PCT or DCT, you will find that cells. So their function is to do the transportation to absorption and to do the secretion. So here the cells are there, the cuboidal cells. So the distance between nuclei here you can see, and these cells are having nucleus and basement membrane. Now next is simple columnar epithelium. It is a single layer of cells that are longer than they are wide. They are having nucleus located near the basement membrane. They are ciliated or non-ciliated. Ciliated means they are having the cilia-like structure. They are having the hair-like projections. And some are not having any hair-like projections, means ciliated and non-ciliated. Some have microvilli. They are also having goblet cells. These goblet cells are having major functions of secrete mucus. They are having major functions of absorption, secretion and protections. So they are at the linings of uterus, stomach and intestine. Especially in case of non-ciliated columnar epithelium cells, they are available in the stomach and anus. Whereas in case of ciliated epithelium cells, so they are available in case of vagina and also in case of the bronchioles. So here you can see the simple columnar epithelium. So it is a part of the large intestine or mucus.
So in intestinal lining, here you can see the microvilli and the nucleus base membrane is available. So they are single non-ciliated column-like cells with oval nuclei near the basement cells. So they contain the coronary epithelium cells with microvilli at apical surface and goblet cells. The microvilli, these microvilli are finger-like cytoplasmic projections increase surface area of plasma membrane, thus increasing cells' rate of absorption. And the goblet cells are modified columnar epithelium cells that secrete mucus, a slightly sticky fluid, at their apical surface. Before release, mucus accumulates in upper portion of cells and causing it to bulge and making the whole cell resemble a goblet or wine glass. Now, pseudostratified columnar epithelium cells. So it appears stratified based nucleus are at two or more levels, and they are not stratified base or all cells touch basement membranes. They are ciliated goblet cells, and their major function is to do protection, secretion, movement of mucus and lining of respiratory system. Especially they are available into the respiratory system, and their function is to do the protection and to having the secretion and movement. So here you can see they are available into this bronchi, bronchial cells here, or in the tracheal cells, and they are also having the cilia to having the secretion of mucus and to do the absorption. So here the basement membrane is available, and just below these cells there is the bunch of connective tissue. Their location is at the ciliated variety lines, air lines of most upper respiratory tract, non-ciliated variety lines, larger ducts of many glands, epididymis, and parts of male urethra. And their functions are: ciliated variety secretes mucus that trap foreign particles, which kill that foreign particles, pathogens or bacteria, and cilia sweep away mucus for elimination from the body. And non-ciliated variety functions in absorption and protection. Next is stratified squamous epithelium. So in that, many layers of flattened cells are available, named based on the appearance of top layers of cells. Their major function is to do the protection. They are available in the outer layer of skin, lining of oral cavity and throat, vagina and anal canal. Here if you see, so they are very protective as compared with the other type of epithelium cells. And here it is a basement membrane, from where here you can see this is the squamous superficial cells are available. So their major function is to do the protection. Two or more layers of cells are available here. The cells in apical layer and several layers deep to it are squamous. Cells in deeper layer are vary from cuboidal to columnar. As basal cells are divided, daughter cells arise from the cell division, push upward toward the apical membrane. And they are specially keratinized stratified squamous epithelium cells develop through layer of keratin in the apical layers of cells. Keratin is the specialized type of protein which is available in that cells, and they are helping to protect the skin and underlying tissue from heat, microbes and chemicals. And relative amount of keratin increase in the cells as they move away from the nutritive blood supply and organelles die. Their location, if you will see, the locations are at keratinized variety forms, superficial layers of skin, and non-keratinized variety lines, wet surfaces, and cover the tongue. Their major function is to protect against abrasion, water loss, ultraviolet radiation, and foreign invasion, and both types of from first line of defense against the microorganism. Stratified cuboidal epithelium. There are 2 to 3 layers of cuboidal cells. Their again function is to do the protection. And linings of larger ducts of mammary glands, sweat glands, and salivary glands, and pancreas, they are available in that area. There are two or more layers of cells are available, and cells in the apical layer are cube shapes and fairly rare type. Again, if you see how it looks, so it is basically occurs in the ducts of adult sweat glands and the esophageal gland and part of male urethra. Their function is due to protection and limited secretion and absorption. Now next is stratified columnar epithelium. Again, its function is protection and secretion. They are available in the vas deferens, part of male urethra and part of pharynx. So here you can see, so they are the basal layer, usually consist of shortened irregular shaped cells. Only apical layers has columnar cells. Their location, as you saw recently, they are at the lines part of urethra and large excretory ducts of some glands such as esophageal glands, small areas in anal mucous membrane and part of conjunctiva of eye also they are available. And their function, as we have discussed, they are having protection of and secretions. Transitional epithelium. So they can stretch as much as you can because they are very tough and they are having the elasticity too much. So they can increase their shape by double their size also. So their distensibility, stretching and protection, it is a main function. And they are available in the inner lining of urinary bladder and the lining of ureters and the part of the urethra. So here you can see they are having the variable appearance, that's why they are called as transitional cells. In relaxed or unstressed state, they look like the stratified cuboidal epithelium, except apical layer cells tend to be large and rounded. As tissue is stressed, the cell becomes flatter and giving the appearance of stratified squamous epithelium. And the multiple layers and elasticity make it ideal for lining hollow structures. For example, in urinary bladder, if you will see, sometimes our bladder is having the quantity of 30 ml, 20 ml, 50 ml, and sometimes it can take the load of 1.5 liter of urine also. So it can do its expansion as much as it can. So here you can see, this is a urinary bladder and it contains these cells. So they can expand according to their requirement. So here also, in bladder, if it is full, so it can be stretched completely. So the lines of urinary bladder and the portion of ureters of urethra, it is available. And it allows urinary organs to stretch and maintain protective lining while holding variable amounts of fluid without rupturing. Now glandular epithelium. So if you see, in that cells that are specialized to produce and secrete substances into duct or into body fluids, the glands, one or more cuboidal or columnar cells, their major function is to do the secretions. And the examples are salivary glands, sweat glands and the endocrine glands. So here you can see the glandular glands are there. The secretions enter interstitial fluid and diffuse directly into the bloodstream without flowing through the duct. So if you see in that, the salivary glands are also available, sweat glands and the endocrine glands are also available. So here the brush powder is also available, and globulate cells, which is having major function as a exocrine gland. There are certain exocrine glands and certain endocrine glands are also included. Now if you will see exocrine versus endocrine. Exocrine that secrete the substance into duct that open into the surfaces, means the point of secretion and point of the stimulation occurs at the same place. So for example, skin and lining of the digestive tract. For example, in case of stomach, the HCl secretion occurs in the stomach, so their stimulation also occurs in the stomach. For example, in the goblet cells, they secrete the mucus at the intestine as well as in the respiratory tract. And also in case of the pancreas, The pancreas secretes the various pancreatic juice. It contains the proteolytic enzymes, for example, trypsin, chymotrypsin, carboxypeptidase. So these are nothing but the examples of exocrine glands. Whereas if you see the endocrine glands, we secrete the substance into the tissue, fluid or blood. Especially they contain the hormones. Hormones like testosterone, progesterone, ACTH, thyroid hormone, after that like these various hormones which has been secreted into our body. For example, insulin is also there, it is also another hormone. And the pituitary gland, we secrete the various hormones like melanocyte stimulating hormone, LH, FSH, growth hormone. So like that, various hormones have been secreted into your endocrine system. Exocrine gland. If you see the exocrine gland, so in that the merocrine cells are there. For example, they are releasing water, protein rich fluid by exocytosis. They are nothing but the merocrine glands. For example, the salivary glands or sweat glands. Next is apocrine glands. It is nothing but the loose small portion of their cell body during secretions. For example, mammary glands and earwax. Holocrine. Holocrine is nothing but the entire cell lysis. Means the whole cell will break down and release some secretions. And during secretions, they are breaking apart. For example, the sebaceous glands of the skin. Now here we can see, as in mammary glands, the cells will secrete the milk from the mammary glands. They are the examples of merocrine. So here the secretory cells are here and the Golgi apparatus is there. So they are responsible for the secretions. And the apocrine means from the one cell it will secrete and to the other cell. And in case of the holocrine, the mitosis replaces lost cell and the cell produces secretions increase in the size. And when the size of the secretion has been increased, and lastly the cell will finally burst, the exocytosis will occur and the release of cytoplasmic content will be so there. So in this fashion, there are three types of secretions has been occur, and the secretory products release into ducts that empty into surface of covering and lined epitheliums such as skin cells or lumen of hollow organs. So as we have discussed, there are secretions at various places, for example, sweat, oil and earwax glands of skin, digestive glands such as mammary salivary glands and pancreas, which secretes into small intestines. They produce substances such as sweat to help lower body temperature, oil, earwax, saliva or digestive enzymes. Serous versus mucus. The serous, for example, typically watery with lots of enzymes or lubrication, and the mucus is nothing but the mucus secretions which occurs in the digestive and the respiratory system, and their major function is to do the protection. Whenever this mucus secretion will occur, it kills the bacteria, it engulfs the pathogens and they will try to kill the bacteria. So in this fashion they are working. If you will see here again in the endocrine cells, the secretions enter into the interstitial fluid and diffuse directly into the bloodstream, and from that bloodstream that typical hormone will carried from one place to the another place, so without flowing through the duct. And the endocrine glands will be very closely, they are connecting in the blood, and they are released at the pituitary gland and they are released at the other places, for example at gonads or in the pancreas, or they are releasing into the thyroid. If you see the examples, they include the pituitary glands at the base of the brain, pineal glands in the brain, thyroid and the parathyroid glands near the larynx, adrenal glands superior to the kidneys, pancreas near the stomach, ovaries in the pelvic cavities, testes in the scrotum, thymus in the thoracic cavity, and their functions are hormones regulate many metabolic and physiological activities to maintain the homeostasis. So whenever our body requires that, so the hormones will release at the same time. So various hormones will secrete according to their stimulations. As we saw in case of the homeostasis, suppose the blood sugar level will be increased, so it will give the signals to the brain, and from that the action can be taken, and there is the secretion of insulin from the pancreatic Langerhans cells, and they will try to decrease the blood sugar level along with the liver. Liver will also help in decreasing the sugar level, means liver will try to convert that glucose into the glycogen. So in this fashion they are working at the same time. So the hormonal level is going to be balanced by the homeostasis constantly into our body. Now in this fashion we have discussed the various cells, and the remaining tissue we will discuss in the next session. So till then we have to say bye, and we'll see in the next lecture. So thanks a lot for hearing my lectures. Next time we will see the remaining tissue.